Thundarr, the Barbarian. The year 1994. From out of space comes a runaway planet, hurtling between the Earth and the Moon, unleashing cosmic destruction. Man's civilization is cast in ruin. 2,000 years later, Earth is reborn. A strange new world rises from the old. A world of savagery, super science, and sorcery. But one man bursts his bonds to fight for justice. With his companions, Ookla the Mock and Princess Ariel, he pits his strength, his courage, and his fabulous sun sword against the forces of evil. He is Thundarr, the Barbarian.
Hi, everybody. It's Hawk here. And today I'm starting a new series. I'm going to talk about every episode of Thundarr the Barbarian. Why? Because I like Thundarr the Barbarian and I thought it would be fun. Also, I kind of wanted everyone else to know about it because I only found out about it a couple of years ago. I am too young, shockingly, to have seen the initial run-through of the show. Also, please forgive any weird outside sounds you get. I don't have a lapel mic and you're going to be hearing motorcycles driving around because I have neighbors with motorcycles. So please forgive that. So anyway, we're going to be beginning with the first episode of Thundarr the Barbarian, The Black Pearl. It has nothing to do with pirates. Anyway, so the first episode, I'm just going to breeze through the plot of these episodes. They're pretty simplistic. They're pretty much just excuses for Thundarr and company to go punch evil wizards in the face for entertainment value. So they're not super deep, they're not super intricate, and the characters aren't super deep or super intricate. But it is fun, and that's kind of the whole reason here. This show thrives off of the insane 80s aesthetic of a post-apocalyptic fantasy hellscape, and I absolutely adore it. Me adore post-apocalyptic fantasy? Pfft, perish the thought. So, we begin the episode with Thundarr Ookla the Mock, the big, totally not a Chewbacca guy, and Princess Ariel. We don't know what she's princess of. We never find out. Riding rapidly through a forest. Again, this is how a lot of episodes start. We start in media res almost all the time because, frankly, I don't need to explain why they're doing anything. They're just doing stuff. So they go riding rapidly through here, and then they run into a guy called Tyrion, something. He's an old guy who is ferrying the pearl. He's being attacked by groundlings, a.k.a. Notskaven. And, well, Thundarr wins with the group. They get the Black Pearl, and then they go to the ruins of Manhattan. You don't get points for guessing where the ruins of Manhattan are. It's Manhattan. Okay, let's... Come on, guys. So, they ride off, leaving the old guy in a bush to heal. And the ground, we get to go see what the groundling chief is doing. He is talking to the great wizard Gemini. I'm gonna take this off, this is starting to hurt my neck. Alright. Enough of my lampshade hat. So, the wizard Gemini, kinda looks like Darkseid, if I'm being honest. Big, metally, really, really cool looking. Looks fabulous. He's very upset that the groundlings didn't manage to get the Black Pearl. However, he is generous in basically giving them a second chance. He tells them to go get all the cool stuff that he gave them to go deal with this barbarian. They do. They show up on motorcycles wielding laser shooting clubs. I told you, don't think real hard on this. Just appreciate how stupidly awesome this is. We have rats riding motorcycles with laser clubs. Go with it. So, Thundarr goes and beats the crap out of them. And this is where we see something that's not really going to happen anymore. It's kind of a episode one-ism. Ariel is significantly more fight-happy here than she is in basically any other episode. It's kind of weird, actually, and I kind of prefer what they do later because it differentiates her more meaningfully from both Ookla and Thundarr, who are both more fight-happy. This also means that Ookla doesn't have to restrain her for plot reasons to get the thing still moving, which he does in this episode. It's just kind of weird. Again, episode one isn't. The writing's also a little eh. The dialogue's not as good as it gets later. They get very good at this about halfway through season one, and then all of season two is just on point. So, that changes, thankfully. She turns into just the smart lady later. You know, the smart lady sorceress later. She's currently still the smart lady, but she's also a little fight happy and whatever. So, after all that happens, Thundarr shows up, returns to the group, and then they go rooting around the ruins of Manhattan that still has movie posters. Somehow. I don't know how. Don't ask me. I don't have an answer for you. This is when we find out that Ariel has a stepfather who has a very large library, at least on history. This is why she knows all the old Earth history stuff. This is how she knows about, you know, pre-cataclysm Earth. There ain't much to go with here. It's just there for fun. It's really just to go, hey, I know what that is, and it's about it. So after they root around in some subways for a little bit, Gemini shows up with his robot knights. We don't know they're robots yet. You'll find that out shortly. And they kidnap Ariel. This does happen throughout the series. Ookla also gets kidnapped, and Thundarr generally gets kidnapped a couple of times. It's not just Ariel getting kidnapped. I think she's probably the most kidnapped, but hey, you know, they spread it out a little bit at least. So she gets kidnapped, and Gemini demands the Black Pearl. We still have no idea what it does, by the way. It's just a shiny rock at this point. It does nothing. No one cares. Well, everyone cares because they're fighting over it, but no one knows what it does other than Gemini and presumably the people who had it. So the citizens of Manhattan? I don't know, dude. Gemini throws some magic at Ookla and Thundarr, and Thundarr's fine. Ookla's paralyzed, but Thundarr's completely functional. Kinda weird. Thundarr notices this immediately and begins to flex it all over Gemini, who bails, basically just stating that you have to give me the pearl or you're never going to see Ariel again. You know, standard villain stuff. From there, they go surface side, and they are attacked by a helicopter full of robots. Again, no one knows this is robots in the show. I'm just going to tell you this right now. So, until that, Thundarr beats the crap out of them by breaking all of their laser guns. And then he finds out they're robots, so he starts stabbing them. I'm going to just explain this now, because I have a personal theory here that is actually backed up by the show. Now, out of universe, the reason why Thundarr doesn't stab actual people with his sun sword, which I've just neglected to talk about because it's just a cool lightsaber and that's all it really is. It's neat. It's a neat, finicky, magical sun sword thing. It's just a fancy sword. It doesn't do much of anything else other than cut through doors that a normal sword couldn't do. And, back to the robots. The theory I have is that he doesn't kill living people who are slaves to the wizards, because A, as the opening tells us, he was a slave at some point. And I think he just wants to give them a choice. He seems to be real big on that. There's a couple episodes later where he'll, like, apprehend a living minion and he'll grab them and, like, demand that they tell him something. You know, he gives them a choice. Do this and run, or I'm presumably going to stab you. They always, of course, take the I will tell you and then run, because, you know, they're cowards and, you know, it's a kid's show. We can't have them stabbing them. Robots, he stabs them, because robots don't have choice. Remember, these are 80s robots. They're true robots, as in they're just beep, boop, shoot, shoot. That's all they are. They don't have, like, higher functioning. They're fancy turrets, if you want to think of them that way. They're really fancy turrets. So, once that happens, he starts stabbing them, he's chopping them up. Him and Ookla are beating the crap out of them. It's a grand old time. So, after that, they steal the helicopter, and Thundarr figures out how to fly it. I told you, don't think real hard on this, just go with it. So they get to Gemini's tower. I've also neglected to say that Gemini has two faces. I have no idea why. It's just really cool aesthetically. Serves absolutely no purpose. Have no idea why he has that kind of modification, but he has two faces. They're mood-based. Go with it. It's fun. So once there, we find Ariel, who's sitting in a cage, and then Thundarr kicks in the door, and Gemini does his big villain yell thing, and Ariel's like, ha, I was waiting for this to happen. And then she hits him with a spell and closes his face mask. Presumably, she should have gotten out a lot easier than this, but honestly, it makes sense that she would wait for Thundarr to show up, because she knows he's going to show up. So why tip your hand that you can, you know, do this and that you're not cowed. It makes sense. She does this periodically later, like Thundarr shows up in the room and then she immediately goes, ha ha, and starts blasting everything. Because, you know, wait for backup to get here. It makes perfect sense to me. After this, they bail, losing the helicopter, but they brought their horses, so they're fine, so they get back to Manhattan with Ariel. And Gemini shows up. This, by the way, is probably one of my favorite just villain entrances in the whole series. It's great. He's there, standing in the air on a cloud. And then he animates the Statue of Liberty. Why? I don't know. But its torch starts shooting fire, and he has a giant fire laser that blows up a skyscraper. So, you know, it's terrifying and highly impressive. Too bad he's too close to it, so when Thundarr chucks this thing at him and breaks it all over the Statue of Liberty, thus deactivating it, he seems to blow up Gemini. Yeah, Gemini goes poof. And the Statue of Liberty just goes back to being a statue standing straight up. Yep, that's how they won. It's kind of cool, actually. There's some disappointment. Thundar's a little angry that they don't have the pearl to, you know, fight the other wizards. But the people of Manhattan seem fairly optimistic because they're like, hey, we know something like this exists now, so we can try to find out how to replicate it and make more of them. So I'm like, well, that's fairly positive. And then they ride off into the sunset. That's how most episodes end. So this episode just tells you exactly what's up with this show. We're going to jump into a plot immediately. We're going to go have our plot of the day. We're going to have our villain of the day. And we're going to solve all of it within about 20 minutes. That's it. Real short, real brief, and I love it. All the characters are spelled out pretty well. Ariel's kind of the only one that changes a little bit, and it's not that much. They just kind of dial down the feistiness and dial up her book smarts and sassiness. She likes puns, by the way. They're not good puns either, but she does enjoy puns. So, get used to that. This also shows us off the wizards. That's the nice part here. This gives us a nice little encapsulation of all the world building you need to know. There are humans, they are subjugated by the wizards, there are other mutants that are subjugated by wizards, and generally speaking, humans don't trust mutants. Don't read anything into this. It's 80s fun, it was very normal. Again, don't read too much into this. I mean, Ookla's technically a mutant, but they like the Mach. So, again, don't go reading anything into that. It's just a surface level this, guys. Like, I'm not doing a deep dive into the true meaning of Thundarr, because it is literally just made to be popcorn entertainment. It's not trying to be deeper, it's just trying to be fun. So go with it. There's gonna be some weird 80s-isms buried in here, you know, some old genre junk. So, I do really like the groundlings. I'm sad they don't show up again, but the groundlings are neat. They are basically just Skaven with motorcycles and laser clubs, and a king. It's neat. I like them. Gemini is just neat. I like his design. I like everything about his design. He's intimidating. I like that he switches between two modes, the nice negotiating kind and the big, boisterous, angry one. I really enjoy that. I like the fact that his robots are literally just dressed up like medieval knights for no reason. Like, he doesn't have to do that. There's no point. He just does. So let's just know a great deal about the wizards that we're going to be seeing from here on out, because we're going to be seeing different wizards as the show goes on. And we get to see that all of them are a little crazy. They're all quite grandiose. They all have lots of power. They like to mix and match mechanical to... I can speak English. They like to mix mechanical things, technological things, sorcerous things. They love shoving them all into stuff. Because, you know, why wouldn't you do something like that? Take full advantage of everything that's in front of you. I thoroughly enjoy it. Also, having robots is an excuse to, you know, let Thundarr stab stuff. So Gemini is in many ways a quintessential wizard that we're going to be running into later. He even does the normal thing we all see, though he's actually not as bad. Later on, we're going to see wizards basically just do things that are going to be the entire reason they lose, because basically they're idiots. You can honestly read into this that, oh, it's just lousy writing, or the fact that it's that consistent. I just kind of want them to... I'm going to be a little generous in my writing aspect here. And that the whole point is that they're just kind of trying to imply that the wizards are all a little crazy and self-destructive in and of themselves, just in their mad pursuit for more power to subjugate other wizards. Which they do. We find that out in another episode. Wizards will wage war on one another using slave armies and anything else at their disposal. It's pretty much all it is. Wizards are in charge here in this wasteland. And that's the other part here. The aesthetic, the setting, everything that's going on is so awesome looking. You've got these just really evocative just set pieces. You have the ruined New York. I don't care that it's 2,000 years later and this is completely unrealistic. The show's not trying to be realistic. It's not even really trying to be all that grounded. It's just there to be fun, hacky weirdness. Just kind of go with it. I like the fact that it doesn't pretend. It just is what it is from the get-go. And you just either buy into it or you don't. And I bought into it, and it's fun. Grab some popcorn, grab a soda, sit on down, and just enjoy watching Thundarr run around with that frickin' sun sword and let Ookla throw a car at something and then have Ariel throw whatever weird light show she throws at people. She's bullshit, by the way. Her magic has no restrictions. It is the softest magic system I've ever seen. She just does stuff. Like, she makes a giant bridge out of light in this episode. She does that a lot, actually. It's a very common thing for her to do. Because they just need to get somewhere. I love it. It's very silly. It's completely ridiculous, and they just do it whenever it's convenient. But other than that, I like the wizards. The wizards are very interesting, because they all look like weird 80s cyborgs. Almost all of them do. Some of them less so than others, but all of them have this funky tech thing going on. So it's like you've got this whacked out mechanical wizard crap going on, and it's really neat and kind of unique. I'm sure there's some other setting I've never heard of, or, I mean, I guess you go, Shadowrun did it, but Shadowrun's doing cyberpunk, and this is not cyberpunk. This is very different. It's just, the whole thing looks like a heavy metal album cover, up to and including the cracked in half moon. I know that's not realistic, and I don't care that it's not realistic. It looks cool. So I hope you all enjoyed listening to me prattle on for quite some time about my joy of Thundarr the Barbarian, as well as this particular episode. It's a bit rough around the edges, and honestly, the other episodes are much better than this one. But honestly, if you enjoyed this episode, you're going to enjoy the rest of them. And if you didn't enjoy this episode, and it was because of the dialogue, well, don't worry, that gets a lot better. If you just didn't enjoy it, well, thanks for listening to me prattle on about it anyway. But I am going to be here talking about all the other episodes, and it's pretty much going to be this format. I will tell you the plot, and then I will prattle on about the stuff I enjoy about it. This one's more of just me going, I love the setting. The setting is really neat. There's no, like, one specific moment other than, hey, it's a giant Statue of Liberty that's shooting giant death lasers that's really cool. And what else do you say about that other than it's a giant Statue of Liberty shooting death lasers at things? More of that, please. So anyway, I hope you all enjoyed this. I certainly did. And I will see you all next time. Watch out for wizards. Peace out, everybody.